been married for quite a while. Got a bunch of kids doing faith in style. They'll tell you that you're awesome and you're not alone. So let's start the show. Who knew Catholics could be so much fun? Greg and Jennifer and how faith is done. Screwing up and trying and forgiving. Adventures in imperfect living. Adventures in imperfect living.
Greetings, folks. I'm Greg Willits from gregandjennifer.com and rosaryarmy.com.
And I'm Jennifer Willits, his significantly older wife.
Coming up on episode 333 of Adventures in Imperfect Living, Jennifer got knives from Walter.
And we go into some Father's Day wrap-up.
We spend a couple trips out on the lake.
Moose for president.
Feedback about returning to Mass.
Prophetic words from Cardinal Sarah.
And how we should be pursuing holiness in an angry world. So put on your happy face and start to tap dance. Episode 333 is starting right now. Hey, as you're listening to the show, as always, if you're listening on a podcatcher on your phone, if you look down right now, you'll actually see images of things that we're talking about, as well as direct links to the various topics and things that we might mention. So take advantage of that. Also, thanks to our Patreon co-producers, including Susan, who actually doubled her patronage, helping Woo-hoo! Us out. Thank you, Susan, for that. We're so glad that you and all of our other co-producers are out there helping us to continue doing this work since 2005. It's amazing that we're still at it, and it's because of people like you who have signed up over at patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. Don't forget, at various levels, you get various benefits. At the entry level, $5 a month. And really, listen, that's like buying one of us a quarter of a cup of coffee each week. That's pretty much all you're doing.
Coffee has inflation problems.
Well, I mean, it's like not even for both of us. Just right. One of us will get a quarter of a cup of a coffee at the $5 a month level. So if you sign up at that, then you get access to our on-demand hangouts, meetups, over 100 pieces of exclusive content just for the co-producers. At $10 a month or more, you'll actually get stuff in the mail. We'll start sending you stickers or you know, surprises. The surprises happen. So we have a lot of surprises to be sending out very soon. I know that, Jennifer, we have a few coffee mug people. We got some sticker and koozie people and other things. So if you are one of our co-producers, keep an eye out for that. It's going to be coming very soon. And if you would like to be one of our co-producers and help us to continue doing this work, go over to patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer right now. So I feel like we are still coming down from last week's birthday show. And I'm kind of, I'll be honest with you. Last night you mentioned, well, doing the show today. And I thought, I just did the show.
I just edited enough audio for the rest of the year.
Last week's show required so much brain effort and emotional effort. And it pretty much had everything in it that we possibly could have in a show that I just, I'm almost amazed that it's already time to do another show. So hopefully you're ready for this one. Hopefully you've recovered from last week's birthday episode and all the people, and then continued to hear from so many people afterwards. So your official birthday was Thursday. We did the show last Monday, so it's sort of like it turned into your birth week celebration.
And it's not over yet, because today, a week later from when we did the show, I actually received my birthday present from Walter, and I talked about this on my Instagram. There's no picture or anything, because at the time I didn't have anything to take a picture of.
You didn't post a picture on Instagram? You just talked about it?
I just mentioned it in the words in the post of my Instagram birthday post.
How did I miss that?
I don't know. It just should have been, you know what? It was in one of my many edits. So my mention did not
So what you're saying is it was so exclusive,
yeah,
no one saw it but you. So you may not have not seen it because she didn't post it anywhere.
And, you know, because I'm a kind mother, I didn't want to, like, put a spotlight on one child and might make the other kids feel bad.
You're doing
maybe
it right now.
Maybe did not do something.
You're doing it now in our most public venue possible.
I love all the gifts from all of the children, no matter what they gave to me on that very fun and special day last week. But I'm really excited about what did arrive today in a big black box that came delivered to our doorstep, and it's that upgraded set of cutlery that we are going to finally enjoy whenever we cook and we have our slicing and dicing needs. We will be doing this with really super sharp knives. So we're intimidated. I'm intimidated. I'm quite used to using dull knives.
Yeah, we haven't had a new knife set since the one that was given to us when we got married 25 years ago.
It was time.
And most of those knives have like made their way to various trash cans over the years until we pretty much are down to like two knives in our kitchen. So Walter is a bit of a foodie, and he's really taken to learning how to cook. And I've actually asked him, I'm like, what have you thought about actually going to culinary school? And I think he would think that it would take away from the fun of just doing it for himself or for others. So he doesn't really want to do it as a profession, but he takes it seriously. I mean, he watches a lot of food videos. He tries to cook a lot. He really takes pride in it. He acts like he's all knowledgeable on various, you know, types of foods and all this kind of stuff. And I'm like, well, he seems like he'd be a good chef, but he comes over and he critiques our knives now because he bought himself a good knife set. And so now he's become a bit of a knife snob, and I blame Alton Brown. I blame Alton Brown entirely. I mean, he watched Alton Brown talking about the importance of good knives, and the next thing you know, Walt's a knife nerd, and then he comes over, critiques ours, and then for your birthday, he wanted to get you a nice set of knives. And so he's kind of at a place where he's able to do something like that, kind of make up for the years where he didn't get you a present. So
I'm really excited to use these knives, and you're right. I've learned so much because of him, and that's what I love about the beauty of large families. And when your kids get older,
they have money and they can buy you knives.
No, it's just that they get this knowledge base that they can turn around and then teach you a few things. So I've learned a lot of cooking tips from Walter, and usually I'm used to being the one who has all the knowledge and then I'm constantly passing on to him. But every now and then he'll just offer me up some great, tidbits of stuff, and now I can benefit. So that's really cool. And I can't wait to actually use them, but the knives are very impressive and I'm super excited. And then our son, Tommy, has already, we have decided a restaurant. He wants to take me out for a mother-son dinner.
He was telling me about that last night too. I'm like, yes. Great, googly and moogly. I mean, they're like totally spoiling you.
Yeah, but we figured out a way to do this a little more cost efficient because we decided that he would take me out to the Cheesecake Factory.
I'm telling you what. I was like, son, do you understand what you're promising your mother?
And I told him that now, here's how we can do it cheaply. We will both order just one moderately priced entree and only get water for the beverage. And we will split one dessert, which we both agree. We already know what it is. We're going to split that strawberry shortcake dessert because it's huge. Two people can eat from that. And he loves it just like I do. So we should be able to get out of there for like $45. That's the plan. But enough about me. I mean, you actually had a wonderful Father's Day just a few days before my birthday. I mean, literally two major events were kind of back to back. And, I wanted you to have a day of sort of relaxing, just have good food and some nice, thoughtful gifts from the kids. And before that, like literally the day before, we had a really fun time going out on the lake. I did not see that event on the calendar. It just came to be like all of a sudden we're going on a boat.
Well, the day before Father's Day, again, a dear friend, my best friend from high school and college. He was the best man when we got married. Lives in Cincinnati. He's my friend Mark. And his daughter moved to Atlanta last year. And so they've been down a lot more to visit. And it's been kind of nice. Been able to get to see my friends more often, and which has been pretty cool. And so he came down to celebrate Father's Day with his daughter, and his wife was here as well. And they were wanting to go out on the lake, and coincidentally, they were staying like on the southern part of the lake that we live close to, Lake Lanier, and they were staying fair distance away from us. Still takes 45 minutes to get over to where he was, and he had texted me and said he was going to try to get a boat for the weekend.
He was going to rent one.
He was going to rent a boat, and was curious if I wanted to go out Saturday morning, and so I didn't get a chance to respond, and I can't remember what the situation was. But I remember I was just really busy when he responded. Or no, we were doing the rosary. He texted me like right when we were starting the rosary. And then when the rosary was over, I completely forgot to respond to him. So the next morning, Friday, he responds back and says, well, I blew it. I waited too long to get a reservation, and so we can't do it. And, you know, if you listen to Mac and Catherine's show, Catholic in a Small Town, Mac's mom has a boat that Mac has been keeping, and he's been holding on to it. We live close to water. His mom doesn't. And so he's had access to this boat and the benefits of boat, having a boat without having to actually deal with boat ownership and all that kind of
stuff. And boat payments.
And we hadn't gone out on the boat this year because of all the coronavirus thing and just, you know, starting to eke out of the quarantine a little bit and being around other people and saying, okay. So I reached out to Mac and I said, I explained the whole situation. And Mac and Catherine said, yeah, well, we'll go out on Saturday. So we got on the boat early Saturday morning, took the boat, cleared to the other side of the lake, picked up Mark and his daughter, and his wife was unfortunately unable to join on the lake that day. We did have dinner with them later on that night. But just the six of us went out and spent the day, a few hours on the lake. I say a day on the lake. It wasn't. We got off around 2 o'clock or something like that because I had to go film mass at church and Tommy had to get to work and we were on the water and just had a great time and just, it was very relaxing and beautiful day and it was very nice.
It was the perfect amount of time, not too long and not too short. And it's sort of like you left right before massive exhaustion could set in. Although it does still kind of catch up with you because you forget if you've ever been on a large lake and you're boating across and just the constant motion of the boat and the way that the boat sort of hits the waves as it kind of scoots across it. And you're constantly scanning your environment. And so it's kind of like you don't even realize how you are expending energy because it looks like you're relaxing on one level. But then by the time you get home, by the time you finally return from a day on the water, everything catches up with you. And it's like, all you want to do is lay down. And so I think we were all surprised.
Yeah. Well, that didn't happen. Like I said, we came home. I had to rush to get Tommy to work. And then I was filming mass that night or doing the live stream at our parish. And, you know, and so I had to gather up all the equipment and set it up and then got home and then we went to grill and then Mark and his family were coming over and they all came over and we're eating dinner and I think it was getting close to 9 o'clock and we're all just now sitting around inside the house and it just kind of fell silent at one point and sort of like, I'm really tired. And they were like, yeah, this day, all of a sudden it's just like the day's caught up, all the activities. But anyway, so on Father's Day itself, had a very nice day, and Walter came up for that as well, and got to be able to hang out. And it was kind of neat how the kids are trying to think of the ways that they can surprise us, you know, with what they have available to. So Ben, because he's all into engineering and he has access to a 3D printer, he comes up with some pretty neat ideas for contraptions using the 3D printer, and so I open up my present from him, and I'm just kind of looking at it. And we all have a joke now. If you're getting a gift from Ben, it's going to be blue. It's just a given. If you're getting a gift from Ben, it's going to be blue. Because that's the color of the plastic filament or whatever it is that he uses with a 3D printer. And so he hands me this thing, and I take it out, and it's like this little box thing. And it has my initials, you know, engraved in it from the 3D printer. And on the side, it says, Happy Father's Day. Love, Ben. But it's like this little box without a top, and it has a hook on the side. And he's like, I want you to figure out what it's for. And I just
kind of... like a square cup.
Yeah. I stared at it for a few minutes, and I'm like, this is to put remote controls in and to hook it onto my
So you figured it out.
Nightstand table. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what it was. Well, what it reminded me is, and you and I talked about these things just recently, it reminded me of the old cup holders that we used to get from fast food restaurants back in the 1970s that you would hook onto the inside, you know, the lip of your window, your car window. So that before, you know, cars had cup holders, fast food restaurants would give you these things so that you would, you know, basically have loyalty to them because you'd see their logo on their cup holder thing. And so it reminded me of that, the little hook mechanism reminded me of that. And my nightstand table always is cluttered with remotes and books, and I always got
it's kind of crazy.
I really don't like it. I wish that I had a better system, or I wish I had shelves or something over there. So anyway, Ben made this thing for me to put it all my remotes in. And the thing that was interesting is I'm talking to him, and he goes, "Well, you can consider it like a prototype because the little hook thing needed a little strengthening, but he can't just strengthen it. He has to basically make a whole new one." So he was going to make me a new one, and he asked me, "Are there any changes you would like to make?" And I'm like, "Well, you know what? I'd love to fit my Kindle in this as well." And then I'm like, "And I'd like a place for my eyeglasses." And he goes, "Well, okay, now it's you're going to use
too much. Now you made it too hard.
You're going to make too much of my stuff." He's very protective over the filament that goes into this thing. And so I said, "Okay, well, I can use my eyeglasses for the original one that you made me. I'll have two cups.
Oh,
so I'll have one for the remotes and I'll have one for my eyeglasses." And I'm like, "Oh, that's fine. I'll look like I have these two plastic drink holders hanging off the side of the night table." So that was kind of cool that he did that. And then Walt made a really interesting Muppets homage video that if you follow Off the Walter on YouTube, you could see that. I'll try to remember to put a link to it. It's a little creepy. It's a very Walter video.
But it is a very so Walter video.
He made that for me, and then the other kids got me some. Like Sam sent me a nice card. Lily got me. I have a weakness for melting chocolate chips and peanut butter in a cup, and she got me some chocolate chips and some peanut butter. And I got that, and then Tommy bought me. I don't buy a soda very often, but every once in a while, I just get a craving. Oh, that's what I should have had just before the show because I was feeling kind of sleepy and I didn't want to have a cup of coffee. He bought me like a 6-pack of the little mini cans of Coke Zero, and so like I've had one. And what is it? You know, it's been over a week since Father's Day, and I've had one this whole time because I don't drink a lot of soda, but every once in a while, Coke Zero is just awesome. So he bought me that. These icebreaker sours that I also
just like. Yeah, your little favorite edibles. But what's so funny about the Coke Zero is you're right that you're really not a soda drinker. I mean, none of us are in the house, so I don't keep a supply of any soda, generally speaking. But because I know you like the Coke Zero, and I know that Tommy has at the time had limited funding, and so he thought, well, maybe I'll buy like favorite soda. It's like, okay, great, that'll be your gift. So I just have to make sure that Greg is denied this gift between now and then.
And I hadn't had a Coke Zero in a long time.
No, but what was so funny is literally I'm on the way to the grocery store and he said, "Oh, Jennifer, hey, while you're in the store, would you please pick me up a 6-pack of that Coke Zero?
As we're talking about it right now, I really want to get up and I want to go get one of those Coke Zeros.
Well, just go ahead and get one. I'll tell the story. I don't care. And so Tommy was literally standing right there and he just opens his eyes really wide, you know, look of terror. It's like, "No, like I have it in my room and I'm holding it until Father's Day." And so it wouldn't be
so
special.
We already had it
in possession. So I just had to say, "Sure, honey. Yeah." And then conveniently forget to get it.
Yeah. But you did get one.
I felt bad.
You lied to me. You said they only had this, or by the time I remembered,
at the cashier.
So you lied. You flat out lied.
No.
You lied.
I did not say anything that was false.
Did you did you not remember it until that moment?
It wasn't a matter of forgetting. I just had to plan not to do it.
Here's what's pathetic. You bought me a single Coke Zero, and this was, and I had it in the fridge, and I was kind of saving it, just going to let it until I really wanted it, right? And then we went out on the boat, and I had to go do that live stream of Mass, and you know, I had to set up all that equipment. I have to get up to the church like an hour before, actually a little bit before, an hour before Mass starts, mm-hmm. because there's a rosary and all that kind of stuff, and I got to get set up. And so I'm like, I have to take Tommy to work, and I grab that Coke Zero, and I was only able to drink about half of it before
you arrived, right?
And so it's in a bottle, and it's got the lid, and I put it aside, and I go inside, and I do I film Mass and I take care of all that. And then I get out to the truck and I get in and I'm like, oh, you know,
is it possible? Still cold?
Is there any inkling of drinkability left in this half bottle of Coke Zero now? Can I have any of this? And I open it up and it's like, psh, you know, so it still sounds fresh. And
you committed. Apparently.
I took a swig and let me tell you what. The answer is 1 hour. The question is, how long does it take for Coke Zero to turn boiling hot in a truck in Georgia the month of June? 1 hour. That's because it was hot Coke Zero,
hot Coke Zero.
It was not pleasant. And I managed to swallow that one sip down. And that was the beginning of my Father's Day, was that hot Coke Zero.
And then I surprised you with a couple other gifts that I knew would be a little bit out of the children's, you know, financial ability to get. And I wanted to finally give you a very particular piece of footwear that you have been wanting for years.
Yeah, I say I've been wanting it. I mean, I've kind of needed it. So when Lily was one, we went to a store. I've worn sandals, you know, before I met you. I remember, I think I got my first pair of sandals when I was like 20. So I've been wearing sandals for 30 years.
It's kind of like hiking sandals, real rugged looking, kind of manly shoes there.
And the pair I had, it only had lasted for a couple of years and it blew out. And we were out of town and I needed a new pair of sandals because my other ones like died. I'm like walking through the parking lot, like dragging the sole of my sandal. So we go into the store. And again, this was in 2010. So Lily was 1 year old.
Not in 2010.
Yeah.
Oh, well, yeah, she was born in 2009.
Okay. Yeah, 2010. Yeah. So she was 1 year old. And we went into a shoe store and asked them if they had any sandals. And they only had like these uber expensive sandals. And they were like $100. I remember choking at the price. I'm like, I can't pay $100 for a pair of sandals. And the guy's like, listen, they're going to last. And, you know, he says, if you have, you know, sore feet, which I always do, you're going to really appreciate having these sandals. And I'm like, I don't know. I can't justify it. He goes, just try them on. And I put them on. I'm like, you made me put these on. And suddenly they're like phenomenal, you know, feeling on my feet. And the guy said, I'm telling you, they will last longer than any other sandals that you have. Any other sandals that you know, because he was asking me a bunch of questions. And basically, he convinced me, it's like, you will get your money's worth out of these sandals. So I've been wearing these sandals. I mean, and listen, when we're in Georgia, if the weather's nice, in Georgia, I can wear these things for like 8 months out of the year. And they are my go-to shoes. If I am wearing shorts, I'm wearing sandals. That's it. But, you know, I wore them going camping in Colorado and in Indiana. I mean, they've been fully submerged multiple times in the beach and on lakes and hiking. They've gotten muddied up. These things, and they still look good. You just rinse them off, and they still look like high-quality sandals. And they're Echo brand, ECCO, mm-hmm. Echo. And I was duly impressed with these from the get-go. And what impressed me is like when I hit like year five wearing these things and they're still holding up, I'm like, this was a good deal. And then I start doing the math because this is the kind of thing that I do. I'm like, okay, so if I paid $100, I've had them for 5 years. It's basically me paying $20 a year for a pair of sandals. And so that's actually pretty good because if you pay $40 for a pair of sandals in the last 2 years. So yeah, that's about what I expected to do. Pay $40. That's what I wanted to pay, you know, 5 years ago. And I would have expected the sandals the last 2 years. And I've gotten 5 years out of it. So I'm doing
it's
the math.
It's saving me money.
And so every year I'm like seeing the cost go down, down, down. Well, the last, I think it was like 2 years ago, I noticed that one of the seams, well, some pieces have fallen off, but they've still, the majority of the mechanics of the sandals worked great still. The soles have held up pretty well. But just like, you know, like the stitching on one side about 2 years ago, the stitching started to go. I'm like, I think I'm gonna have to get another pair of these. But I just then suddenly the year would end, and I'm like, oh, okay, I didn't have to get one this year. I made it through another year, and then I do it again. And so I've had these things for 10 years. I've been wearing the same sandals for 10 years, and I cannot. I have no other shoes that are used as much and as hard as these sandals are, and I was totally prepared to see if I could go for year number 11. I was fully, fully prepared to go for number 11. And now it was kind of getting to the point where I was curious to see, well, just how many years can I go with these things? And so I was fully invested in this. But again, 10 years, paid $100. So I basically have paid a $10 rental fee for sandals that I have used. I'm paying like less than $1 a month for these sandals. So to me, I don't get excited about clothing or shoes or whatever, but this company, if they continue making shoes at this quality level, I'll never buy any other brand. Mm-hmm. And so you got me a new pair of Echo sandals. And
do you know when I got it?
When you got it?
Yeah.
No.
I've had it for like 2 months in my closet. Right when the pandemic hit and I realized shipping could possibly be affected.
You went ahead and bought them?
I went ahead and bought them so that I would not have any worries.
I could have had these at the beginning of the season then.
Yeah, but anyway, you had to wait for it.
So I put these new ones on and immediately I'm like, oh, no, wait, no, something's wrong. Something's wrong. Something's wrong.
It's new.
But if you look at the ones I've been wearing for 10 years, like on the left foot, and I do this to all my shoes, I have like this crater of a toe indentation on the inside of, you know, on the sandal, that I'm like, well, now I have to make a new toe groove in the new sandals. But I've been wearing them for a week and I'm already completely used to the new ones.
Oh, awesome.
But we saved the old ones. And so like, on your birthday, we went out on the boat again with Mac and Catherine, and I wore my old ones. And so I want to see if I can wear my old ones whenever I'm going to be, you know,
doing something potentially more messier.
Yeah, getting
or
them wet, yeah. You know, helping Matt get the boat out of the water, something like that, where I'm going to have to walk into the water. I'm going to wear these old ones, and I want to see if I can get 15 years out of these new ones.
I don't see why you couldn't.
We're not going to go camping anytime soon, going to do any, like, destruction level work like I did in college. I mean, they one time I wore them when we went camping, and I was like, I don't know if I'm going to be able to resuscitate these. Yeah, hose took care of it. I'm like, they're fine after that. So anyway.
And then after that, I decided to get you this other gift that was actually inspired by a longtime supporter and listener of the show. And she oftentimes joins us over for our live rosary streams, and that's Angie. She is also a Patreon co-producer. And so she participated in one of our Patreon live monthly hangouts. And we could see like her space where she was sort of being in the Zoom call with us. And we just like, we wanted her to tell us about her area, her room, her like her prayer space. And she has all these like icons on her walls. And it was so impressive. So we just asked her, well, what are all those pictures? Because they were just too far away for us to see. And she basically described it as her Saint Posse wall. And just something about that phrase, Saint Posse wall, like, you know, we all talk about who's your tribe, what tribe do you want to be a part of? And like, what better tribe than to have a saint tribe to be a part of? That's one of the most wonderful parts of being Catholic. One of the great benefits is that we have so many saints to learn about and be inspired by. And all of us naturally are sort of drawn to very particular saints in our life. And Greg and I have always been impressed by the saints who have a great love of the Blessed Mother. So we tend to just have a little cluster of saints that we will probably, you know, ask for intercessory prayer for. And you bond with them throughout the course of your life. And in Greg's new office setup here in the house, the walls are still pretty bare. We're still trying to decide, you know, how what will be a good and fitting decor for your space. And then I knew that having a Saint Posse wall would just be very fitting. And so we already have one that we acquired. I don't know what state we were living in when we got Saint Francis de Sales.
That was in Indiana.
In Indiana. But I've been impressed with the size. So it's like 11 by 14, which is, you know, it's good for hanging on a wall. So I thought, I'm going to add another saint to his posse. And then you can go up to five, okay? Because the wall is just perfectly spaced out. You can get five really good saints. And so we have three more that we could shop for over the next, you know, however long we want to take to find just the right ones. But the one I decided you should have is a saint you have talked about on this podcast for years. And that's none other than Saint Maximilian Kolbe. I wasn't even sure if I could even find an icon for him that was painted in that same style as Saint Francis de Sales, but it was there. Went over to that monasteryicons.net and they had it.
.com.
And so
I'm looking at it right now.
I was just like, yep, this is it. So you see, Angie, you like unknowingly witnessed to others by allowing us to see your prayer space in your house. And now we want to get a St. Posse wall that is sort of customized for Greg.
I'm really surprised the St. Dominic one doesn't have him holding a rosary.
Oh, that's odd. Well, what other saints would you like to be in your Fab Five of saints?
If I had to choose, like right now, St. Dominic just kind of makes sense because, you know, he's the one who first propagated the rosary. Mm-hmm.
St. Louis.
Yeah, St. Louis Marie de Montfort. I've never seen an icon of him.
Yeah.
And even though I don't have a particular devotion to him, I feel like I should. I feel like I should have a devotion to St. Gregory the Great because he's my namesake. Mm-hmm. And it's a nice looking one too. They have a nice Gregory the Great icon. I feel like I should have, but they do have a St. Isidore the Worker icon. And
why is that?
Well, the farmer. The St. Isidore the Farmer is oftentimes referred to as the patron saint of the internet.
Oh, okay.
And so there was definitely a time where I, you know, reached out to him and said, "Can you help me?
I need good connection to evangelize." Yeah.
Can you make this dial up connection work, please? But I really don't know. St. Joseph, I wish I had a better devotion to him, but I don't. I do wish that it was better. I have a long and storied history with St. Joseph that I know it's all me.
It's a complicated relationship.
It's complicated. I can't explain it. I wish that I had a better relationship with St. Joseph. I know I should. But also just having one of Jesus.
And Mary, for that matter.
Yeah, we have one of Jesus. Maybe it's too small.
It's a different size.
Yes, right, exactly.
We need it to be bigger.
That would make sense, just to get one of Mary.
One of Mary, one of Jesus. You got those two saints, and you're just down to one more.
Yeah, here's one right there, Our Lady of the Rosary. I should have, that should be one.
No brainer.
I do kind of like these. They do have some, I'm looking at it right now, and they're discounted. It's a story icon pair. And I don't fully know all of what the story is on these, but it's basically an icon in the middle, and then there's smaller icon images around the periphery of the image. And that's kind of interesting, but anyway, there's a few. Yeah, I could just get all ones of Mary. Now that I'm looking at
them. They're beautiful.
Yeah, all the ones of the Blessed Virgin are all the Immaculate. Oh, the Immaculate Heart and Sacred Heart. That would be a really great one to have those matched.
We still want to get a statue that complements the Marian statue that we have here.
And I go look at that every once in a while, and I'm like,
how much is it? Was it like, it was a lot of money, like several hundred dollars.
Yeah, it was like $300 or $400. And I was like,
Mary needs some touch-ups. I'm wondering if you can maybe touch her up with some of the paint.
Yeah, I don't want to do that until we have the Jesus, because some of the paints might need to be matched. So anyway, so we've had a lot of blessings in the last week or so, because between Father's Day and your birthday and all sorts of other things have been happening, and it's just definitely very thankful time in our life right now.
Hey Greg and Jennifer, Don from Pennsylvania here. Hope you're all staying safe and healthy and well. Hey, I just listened to your interview with Moose, your friend, and I have to tell you, everybody's so sick, or at least I am, of all the rancor and the news and the agendas and the politics of all the racism. And your interview was just straight up, no agenda but forgiveness, mercy, and let's move forward from a white guy and a black guy who are regular Americans. Moose for president. You for vice president. Let's get it done, and this place will be a lot better shape. Great interview, great discussion. I felt like I was sitting there with you guys, and I really appreciated it a lot. God bless you both. Take care. Hope everyone stays safe.
Great hearing from you, Don. I got to tell you, I'll pass on the vice president position. I have no interest whatsoever to do anything like that. But it's kind of funny that you mentioned Moose for president, because what's awesome is years ago when we were living in Georgia originally, and we were living closer to where Moose lives, we were both in the same county. There was some sort of election going on. I can't remember what it was. But I I did not want to select any of the people that were available for one of the particular ballots that was there. And you aren't supposed to take pictures when you're inside the voting booth. But I snuck my phone out and I just went, you know, I took a picture. I have it somewhere. I know it's probably in iPhoters or something if I go back and look for it. But I actually have a picture, and then I texted it to Moose where I wrote him in for a position in our county. And I'm like, so if you get elected, it's all my fault. You know, because
one vote.
Yeah, that one vote's going to get you in. But I was like, just about if I ever do have to write in a write-in vote for something,
it's like, do that to his wife? Poor Shelley.
I might be voting for Moose for president this year. Let me put it that way. We got another email about that from Scott. He says, I finally got a chance to listen to episode 329, Facing Racism, while riding my bike yesterday. Unbelievable. One of the best dialogues I've heard in a long time on this topic. The three of you presented very thought-provoking questions and dialogue. Have you given any thought to breaking out just that interview because of its importance in our society today? No, I have not. It's a good idea. I just don't think that I don't know how I could get it any more distributed than it already has. So I don't know. I'm so busy with other stuff right now. Yeah. That's like I thought about it, and when I got your email, Scott, I was like, I've been mulling it over, quite honestly, since then. And even now, as we're talking about it again, I'm like, should I? It's like, I probably won't, to be honest with you. I mean, it's not that I think it's a bad idea. I think it's a really good idea.
But honestly, I just don't think YouTube is not going to let it get seen because we have no algorithm for it.
Oh.
We don't have a precedent for it. It's all silver hair now. My hair took over. It dominated.
Well,
it always does. I'm sorry. So, I'm sorry. It's just what YouTube did.
We got quite a bit of feedback after 2 weeks ago, that episode of Oceans of Mercy.
Yep, Angie Thomas wrote to us and she writes, Greg and Jennifer, I just wanted to thank you for the sacrifice of time, talent, and treasure et al. That you have put into the live Holy Rosary prayers. From your last podcast, I know you are considering the lifespan of this form of the apostolate, so I just wanted to take the time and really express my thanksgiving and to let you know Rosary Army is still reaching people. No, I am not trying to keep you going. I cannot know where God is leading you to next. I am just here for whatever it is. Looking forward to the Rosary book, though. It honestly took my breath away on the reading the other night. Do you want to take a moment to explain what you just did?
Well, I don't even remember if I've actually mentioned this on our podcast.
I don't think you have.
I get confused on what I say on the podcast and what I actually say
on the Rosary stream.
On the live Rosary stream, because sometimes the live Rosary stream turns into like little mini podcasts where we talk a little bit. But one of the things that, for the launch of the new Rosary Army website, one of the things that we've talked a lot about and prayed a lot about, and I've kind of had it on my heart for a while to do this, I'm actually writing a new book. And I'm a good ways into it now. It's not finished, but, you know, a good ways into it. And I've kind of struggled with it a little bit because my intention was to give it away for free. And then as I started writing it, I'm like, well, you know what? This is actually becoming much broader and much more expansive book than a typical free ebook would be. So then I started questioning, well, should I submit this to publishers and try to get it published? And then you said, and other people have said, it's like, you know what, this is something that will really serve the Rosary Army community. And so my plan is this book, when it's finished, I probably will hire an editor to give it a good once over and clean up and that kind of thing. But once it's done, and I would like to have some religious read through it, make sure I have, you know, all the theological content is correct. And we plan on giving it away for free. And so I'm writing a new book. It's called Increase Your Peace with the 15 Promises of the Rosary. And so one night after we were praying the Rosary on our live stream, I shared the first couple of chapters and read them out loud on our live stream. And so people got a chance to offer a little bit of feedback on it and help me make sure I'm going in the right direction. But so far, I'm really pleased with the way the Holy Spirit is directing the book. I've been writing in it pretty consecutively most days. I think I wrote 500 or 600 words this morning already in it. So
wow, that's awesome.
So it's coming along and diving into the, you know, we've always had the list of the 15 promises of the Rosary listed on Rosary Army's website, It's in the Rosary Army mobile app. But some of them, I think,
need a little explanation.
Well, what I'm realizing is I think that there should be, I'm starting to come to the belief, the strong belief, that there needs to be a renewal of understanding of these 15 promises. And if people understand these 15 promises, their desire to pray the rosary will be greater, and therefore they're going to have greater peace in their lives. And that's ultimately what we're trying to do right now, is help people have more peace. That's becoming sort of a mantra with Rosary Army, is pray the rosary, have more peace. And so if you understand these promises of the rosary, and then you have a little bit of background, and you have some, you know, some substantial backup in being able to explain these 15 promises, that I think that it will help a lot of people to have a greater desire for praying the rosary. Because I know praying the rosary can be kind of tough. For some people, it can be kind of dry, but you need a why, right? If you have a why am I praying the rosary? Why am I doing this? What good is going to come from it? And I think that that's something that's going to hopefully come out from this book. So I'm excited for that. It's a free ebook that I'm planning on giving. Probably what I, in the back of my mind, just so you know, what I am kind of planning on doing is I will make the ebook available for free so people can download it. But I'm kind of thinking I may make the paper version and an audiobook version available for purchase, because some people want that.
That's a great idea.
Some people want that convenience. And since, you know, I'm putting in a lot of work and writing a full book, and it's something that basically is being given away for free to support the Rosary Army ministry in the hopes that people will support Rosary Army.
Yeah.
It'd be nice to have, you know, some sort of remuneration to help us to continue doing the work. You know,
so. Yeah. No, that's a great idea. And
I've done that before, by the way, where I've gotten a free ebook and I'm reading it. I'm like, you know, I want to be underlining. I want to underline this book, and I end up buying the paper book. So, you know.
And it helps the author in multiple ways to keep them supported. So that's all very good. And I wanted to get back to Angie's email, but because it's been a couple of weeks, it might be a little difficult to remember what exactly she was responding to. And a couple of weeks ago, when we were more intensely discussing the future of Rosary Army, like what to do with the Rosary live streams and that sort of thing, and how really to better spread the word of what we're doing so that we can have greater participation in the Rosary live streams. So to that point, I can't believe I called Angie Andy. Ah, sorry, Angie. Most evenings, she writes, I actually post a link with a photo of me or my environment as I begin to pray, because I think it actually connects with the people on my social media who know me a little better. Really, this is just Facebook, but I think that's how some evangelization needs to happen right now. As face-to-face as we can get. So far, I have heard from 3 people on phone calls now that they are clicking the link and watching and praying, and a few others who comment, not every night, but often. To me, this is a miracle because of the lifestyles, at least of 3 of these people who currently are leading. Not that I am judging them, not my job. I pray and God works. However, and in whatever time he has planned, one person, my sister, who would be a saint if it weren't for the same-sex relationship she has been in for more than a decade. We were not brought up in a Christian home and had no experience of it outside of our great-grandparents, which I lived with, but she was too young to remember. The other is a fallen-away Catholic who loves the rosary because it reminds her of her very devout mother who passed. She told me she loves to listen, and it brings her such peace in all of this chaos and brings her fond memories, even though she struggles with the faith. Her husband is an open socialist and very negative toward her upbringing. I also heard from a person who reads the photos of the highlighted Magnificat I post who has no experience of God. Her question to me once was, "So, who is God anyways? Like Mary's husband or what? How does this work?" Ooh, I pray for a revelation of God to these loved ones every night, reparation of sins and conversion for all, as I know you do. As I've learned from you, prayer is the most powerful and loving thing I can offer another person. And I think the rosary, in its reflections of the mysteries of life and virtues of Christianity, is the easiest way to reach people. It's just a simple rote prayer, but it leads to deep contemplation in time. So I thank you, Greg and Jennifer, and all of your family for everything you do, because
I have proof that it works. You are wonderful pencils in the hand of our loving Father, and I am so thankful for you. Remember this each time the unholy divider gives frustrations and negativity and doubt. You are a gift. Thank you, Angie.
That's very nice.
That was so nice. And, you know, thank you for showing us that what we do does make a difference to people in ways that we can't ever imagine or expect. So thank you, Angie, for writing in to us, giving us your feedback, and letting us know it makes a difference.
Hey, Greg and Jennifer, Chris in Minnesota here. Just finished Oceans of Mercy while I was mowing the back 40. And I had a couple of thoughts, three thoughts actually, regarding the show, which was a great discussion, by the way. Wonderful discussion. Appreciate all the questions and wondering why and wondering about this and that. Three things, though. Wanted to, one, Jennifer, whatever happened to the little arrangement you had with your pastor about going last to receive on the tongue? Thought that's what you and he kind of worked out. Second, regarding streaming, focusing while streaming the Mass. See what I did there? Focus while doing television. My wife Lisa and I have been streaming our Mass, one of our Masses each week since the beginning of the pandemic, and I agree with you. It's difficult to focus. But then I always just think that I think I'm a little given a little slack by God because we're doing something for people who can't be there in person. So that's how I deal with my lack of focus at times. And secondly, thirdly, thanks for sounding out ideas with each other, bantering back and forth. It became really interactive. I mean, not just for you two, but for me too, because I found myself answering you and saying, hey, what about this? What'd you think about that? So it's really interactive, at least on my end. So thanks much. Take care. God bless and have a wonderful day.
Thanks, Chris. Good hearing from you as well.
So I guess I do owe a follow-up on the Eucharist situation.
Oh, wait, this is going to take a while.
Yeah. So sit back, relax, pour yourself a nice cold carbonated beverage. No. It's going to overflow, Greg.
Yeah, you're talking. They couldn't hear it. Oh, listen. Can you hear it?
It came in and out. It's the fizz. It's all foam, though. You poured it too fast, Greg. Right. You can't do that. You got to pour it at an angle.
Anyway.
Always at an angle.
That's beer. All right.
And Coke. Okay. Anyway, getting back to what's been going on with the reception of the Holy Eucharist at Mass. Wow. It is a really big story. And I'm not quite sure I can share all of it yet, but I've been sitting on a very big story. At least it's big to me, because there's some interesting names in this story, but I feel like I'm still gathering information. Okay.
Since you're struggling, I'm going to say this.
Okay.
Okay. So we've talked in recent weeks, and you've heard us kind of wrestle with going back to Mass and how we're able to receive the Eucharist and what's allowed and what's not allowed. And the Archdiocese of Atlanta, they even put it on their website. They've never said that you cannot receive the Eucharist on the tongue. However, it's sort of inferred, and it's there, that in doing so, particularly depending upon your parish and the susceptibility of your fellow parishioners to the coronavirus because of age or whatever it might be, that in doing so, additional health precautions might need to be made, cleaning up and that kind of thing. And the Archdiocese said that on the website as well, but it should be done discreetly, right? But it's one of those things, and you know, we've wrestled with this. Talking about wrestling with topics, we've wrestled with the idea of how do we receive the Eucharist right now in a time where our pastor's trying to show a lot of sympathy to the other people who are still being very cautious, but they're showing up for Mass and they want to receive, you know, on the hand, and he's going back and forth. Is that going to cause more angst for other people? So we've decided just basically to abstain for right now. And
to make a spiritual communion. Until we're at a point where our pastor can more, you know, calmly and openly distribute in any way that the parishioner sees fit to
But that's quite honestly, I feel like something else is happening though. That fine, we can take the logistics and it's because of the coronavirus and everything else. But here's the deal. And this is what I've been thinking about and praying about. We have because of the coronavirus, because masses were closed down for most of the United States at least, and who knows what's going to happen in coming weeks, we've been denied the Eucharist. Now, do we have a right to the Eucharist? That's the question. Well, no, not really. We don't have a right because it's a gift freely given. So you don't have a right to a freely given gift. Okay? And the graces that come from receiving the sacraments, that too is a freely given gift from God. My question, though, that I've been asking myself is this everything that we've been dealing with? And I would go even further beyond the coronavirus and just say the division with Black Lives Matter and the political division, which is just heated and so ugly right now. And now we're having the argument and the fighting. And I just saw a video today of a guy being arrested because he refused to leave a store when he wasn't wearing a mask. Now the video just shows him basically being wrestled to the ground by a cop. But he went into a store, and you don't see this on the film, but they say that they asked him to leave because he wasn't wearing a mask. He just said, I forgot my mask, and next thing you know, the guy was being arrested. And there was an altercation with the cop, too. And you just see stuff like that, you're like, how are we here, right? And then video over the weekend of protesters going to march to the, I think it was the governor's office or governor's mansion in St. Louis, going down a wealthy neighborhood. And this was all in the news today. I don't know if you saw this, Jennifer, but a wealthy couple, they're both married, or excuse me, both lawyers, standing outside their house as the protesters are going by. And the guy has a rifle in his hand, and his wife is outside with a handgun because it was private property. It's not public mm-hmm. property. I mean, they pay for the street repair. They pay for the sidewalks. None of it is private property. And so now you have this I won't say mom, you have these protesters mm-hmm. streaming down their private street. So there's questions there. It's like, anyway, the point is division, 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 division. And then, you know, for whatever reason, timely enough, this week I was compelled to restart, because I never finished it, the book, The Day Is Now Far Spent by Robert Cardinal Sarah, which we talked about on our shows last fall. We talked about it on This Is What We're Dealing With Mac and Catherine. It came up on our podcast as well. But in this book, Cardinal Sarah talks about division as well in the first 20 pages or so. And he talks about the division that's happening. And again, where do divisions come from? Who wants divisions? The devil is the one who wants divisions. If he can find a way of separating people, he's going to do it. And if he can make it so that the separation between people actually looks like a good, that's even better for him. And as I'm reading this, and it's kind of amazing because this book came out in February, or he wrote the first part of it in February of 2019, came out at the tail end of 2019. But the sections where he's talking about the divisions, he almost could have written it last week. And the introduction is called Alas, Judas Iscariot. And he talks about, you know, meditating. He actually spends time meditating on Judas and the amount of Judas that we have in our own lives by the way that we act, by the way that we see people around us acting, by our inability. Basically, what was Judas's, you know, main problem? He stopped trusting Jesus. He started thinking he knew better than Jesus does. So that's really key right there. Judas's problems began when he started thinking that he knew better than what Jesus knew. And Cardinal Sarah talks about this in his book, about the church's suffering. She's trampled on, he says, and her enemies are within. Let us not abandon her. All pastors are sinful men, but they bear within themselves the mystery of Christ. What is to be done then? It is not a matter of organizing and implementing strategies. Okay, what have we been doing for the last 6 months? We've been organizing and implementing strategies. What is the church doing right now? Organizing and implementing strategies, strategies for closing the churches, strategies for reopening the churches, strategies for how we receive the Eucharist, strategies for how we should not receive the Eucharist, strategies for how we do the live stream, strategies for the... How could anyone think that we could improve things by ourselves? How could anyone think that we could improve things by ourselves? That would be to enter again into the lethal illusion of Judas. Given the surge of sins in the ranks of the church, we are tempted to try to take things into our own hands. We are tempted to try to purify the church by our own strength. Cardinal Sarah says that would be a mistake. What would we do? Form a party? A movement? That is the most serious temptations, the showy disguise of division. Under the pretext of doing good, people become divided. Okay, under the pretext of doing good, people become divided. Think about Catholics right now. How do we go to Mass? How do we receive? How do we do this? Do we wear a veil? Do we not wear a veil? Do we kneel? Do we not kneel? Is that Pope good or is that Pope bad? Is that Bishop good or is that Bishop bad? And then he goes on and says, they criticize each other. They tear each other apart. And the devil snickers. He has succeeded in tempting good people under the appearance of good. We do not reform the church by division and hatred. We reform the church when we start by changing ourselves.
Now, stop right there.
Stop right there.
Exactly.
We reform the church when we start by changing ourselves. Let us not hesitate, each one in his place, to denounce sin, starting with our own. So I want to hone in on those couple of last sentences there, because at the risk of sounding like I'm tooting my own horn, that's what I have been trying to do for a while now. And I've been doing it a little bit, I think, more quietly than I have in the past, in years past, where when we were on radio and we kind of had to keep a conversation going, or even on the podcast, trying to get a conversation going. And sometimes, you know, especially in radio, we had to take a more firm approach. That was the expectation, right? Take a more firm approach and stand your ground, that kind of thing. And I never really liked that. And in the last couple of years, with everything that's going on, I've kind of realized I don't have a lot of firm answers these days. But what I know I need to be doing is, what do you want, God? And here's what I could say. Here's a huge blessing that happened to us that I feel like is playing out my ability right now in basically just making a spiritual communion and abstaining. I don't deserve anything. I don't deserve anything. And I'm not saying that in some holier than thou. I don't. But by the goodness and graciousness of a loving and merciful Father, he gives me what I need when I need it. And so, yeah, we have received the Eucharist on the tongue since churches have reopened. We have. Do we get to every single Sunday when we want it on our command and on our desire and on our instruction? No. Can we be more lenient and understanding of the struggle of our pastors and bishops? Well, yeah. And if you listen in the past, I have not always been that way. I mean, when I say in the past, I'm like 2 months ago. I mean, it's been a struggle. And listen, we're all struggling. We all struggle. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. And then if you can come back and say, you know what? I was pitching a fit about not receiving the Eucharist, and I probably went overboard. I probably made someone feel bad. Or flip it around and say, I didn't take the Eucharist seriously enough. And so what I'm saying is, in this time right now of all this division and all this turmoil, division in the church, division in politics, all this, we reform the church when we start by changing ourselves. We do not reform the church by division and hatred. Let us not hesitate, each one in his place, to denounce sin, starting with our own. What sin do you have in your life that you need to denounce? How do you need to change? And is this time of painful separation from each other, and the divisions in our families, and the divisions among, in some cases, even between spouses. Is this a punishment, or is this an opportunity for us not to be chastised by God, but to chastise ourselves and to identify and look the sinfulness in our lives and squarely in the face and say, I did that, I am wrong, I am sorry, and I am going to make a firm amendment to change, period. How much are we willing to truly allow this time of turmoil to be a time for us to genuinely trust God? I said a few minutes ago that we have been blessed by God with a rare opportunity, which is this. You've heard us tell the story in various ways and from various angles of how things sort of fell apart for us in Indiana. Well, that happened over 2 years ago. I have not had regular full-time employment or health insurance in over 2 years now. We have made the comment, kind of in passing, that we are living on loaves and fishes. And what we mean by that is God somehow takes what we have and multiplies it. We heard just recently the gospel reading, once again, if God will take care of the birds in their nests, how much more does he care about us, and how much more will he care for us, and he will provide for our needs. And what I've realized throughout the course of all this coronavirus and division and politics and all the problems that we're having is, do I trust God or not? At what point can I no longer trust God and I have to take it upon myself to take care of things? At what point do I need to use my own strength to purify my situation? At what point do I need to form a party or a movement? At what point do I give in to that most serious temptation of the disguise of division under the pretext of doing good? All these things that Cardinal Sarah talked about, I kind of feel like before the coronavirus hit, we were already making those realizations of how much we've been forced, that's the wrong word, how much we've been given the opportunity to truly learn how to trust God. It has not been easy. This has been 2 years of struggle. But to be able to say, do we trust God with all that we have? And are we going to live in a state of trust or state of fear? So even I'll give you another example. So, you know, again, don't have a regular job, don't have health insurance. A month and a half ago, you know, it's getting hot. We haven't been exercising like we used to. We made an investment. We were like, oh, we went and bought a treadmill. That, I could easily have found a million reasons why that was an expense, because it was expensive. Buying a new treadmill is expensive, but buying that so that we could take better care of ourselves. But I could stop and go, okay, at what point in my life, what level of stability and security and how many T's need to be crossed and I's need to be dotted before I can say with absolute certainty that my life and our savings aren't going to be dissipated and our financial situation isn't going to collapse if we buy that thing, right? Because the temptation is to say, well, we can't do anything. We can't do anything in our lives because we don't know if it's all going to come crashing apart. And that's the wrong way of looking at things. We have to say, well, right now we have the finances. We're able to buy that thing. It will be good for us. It's a stress relief. It'll help us sleep better. And again, I was having terrible insomnia. I've been sleeping all through the night.
Legs are better.
I'm not having my jumpy legs like I normally do. I mean, it's like it is better for my health. So if I wasn't doing something, let me tell you what, it's going to cost us a lot more than what the treadmill cost in, you know, 5 or 10 years from now when my health gets worse again. So my point in saying that though is that it's something as stupid as a treadmill, but to me it was like it was an act of trust of God.
Right.
Of like, do I trust? So if we spend X amount of dollars on that treadmill, is God going to take care of? Is God going to go, well, you guys screwed up. You know, how dare you use the money on something like a treadmill when I wanted you to use that money to do X, Y, and Z? Well, we don't know. We can only do. And so my point, though, is that that's one example of I think the temptation is to, when you're trying to trust God, to not really go all the way in trusting Him. You trust Him to a point. You want to make sure that you have 100% of your emergency fund in place. You want to have 100% of this in place. You want to make sure all your ducks are in alignment, and then you'll begin to trust God. That's not trusting God. That's being Judas. That's, you know better than God, and God can't take care of things the way He said He's going to take care of things. That's what Judas thought, and that's why Judas acted the way he did. And that's harsh. And I'm saying that from the perspective of someone who has acted most of his life like Judas. But now, we're basically making what we made 25 years ago when we got married. And yet somehow we're being taken care of. And if anything, I should be louder about that. I should, if we have this platform and a microphone, if I really want to say I'm Christian, I should be saying, listen, God will take care of you. Look what He's doing for us. He's going to take care of you. And so then we know people say, well, but I'm unemployed, or we got sick, or yes, yes, yes. And those things happen. That's by the state of our world. But God will provide. God will take care of you for what you need, not what you want. And I really have been able to see clearly Him doing that in the last 2 years.
And recently we've had three opportunities to demonstrate this trust that you just talked about. One was with a educational change for Lily.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was a big one right there. And the whole time was like, all right, Lord, we are taking a step in faith. You know our finances better than I do, actually. You know it way better than I do. But Lord, if this is good, if this is good for Lily, if this is good for our family, then I will take a step toward this school and apply and not worry about the money at all, because I know You will provide. You are our provider. And so we took one step at a time, praying the whole way through, and now she's going, and we're going to have to pay those fees or whatever, and I don't care. I'm fine, because I know God will provide. Number two, Rosary Army. You know, you've heard us talk all about our brainstorming ideas of things we can do for Rosary Army, but every now and then we come across a situation where we just need to hire someone to help us with writing and marketing and all that, so that we can do what we're good at and let somebody who's really good at marketing and writing do that. So we had a conversation, and Greg, you looked at me and says, Jennifer, can we afford this? Can we do this? And I'm like, you know what? I don't have to see it in the bank. We just have to trust God that if this is good, it will work out, and we will do it. We will just do it. Because is it good? Yes. Will it magnify the message and the reach? Yes. So let's trust God and do what is good. And I think there was like a third major,
This
we can tell you about this one, because this is fresh off the presses.
Are you ready for your mind to be blown? So we've prayed about this a lot on our live rosaries. So if you join us for live rosary, you've heard us talk about the fact that our son Sam has been engaged for a while, but they weren't necessarily in a place to be able to make that happen with the coronavirus, with their finances, with a million other things. Getting married is actually kind of difficult. And I mean, that's something that when I was working in the Archdiocese of Denver, that was one of the things that my office was responsible for, was marriage prep. And that was a big concern for a lot of people, that if they wanted to get married in a particular church, and there were sometimes a few too many loopholes that people, not loopholes, that's the wrong word, hoops that people had to jump through. And Sam and his fiance have been discouraged by the marriage prep process and that kind of thing. And quite honestly, they need marriage prep. I'm a big believer in marriage prep. But at the same time, the sacraments are something that for people that are ready and want it, that it should be available to them. Well, they've been going to a new church, and the pastor has been working with them. And even though they haven't been there for 6 months, the pastor's like, well, we can do this. And so he's actually been more encouraging of helping them make it happen faster than any of us expected it. And so suddenly they got a date. And by the way, Sam just got a new job, and that also made it complicated, because suddenly the time off that he would have is very, very limited. So the priest looked on the schedule and said, well, we can do it as soon as August, which kind of blew us away. And again, they want to keep it simple. So do we.
It's literally just a wedding mass.
They don't have a lot of money. We don't have a lot of money. But we were talking, okay, how are we going to do this? So our son's going to be getting married. And we want to be there. Jennifer and I want to be there. So we're thinking, okay, and the boys will already be in school. And so maybe it's just going to be you, me, and Lily. Do we drive? How do we do this? And again, you know, a couple days pass, and then suddenly it's becoming, you know, it's more firm. The date's becoming more firm. And, you know, we're talking about it again. And the second time you and I talked about it seriously, suddenly I was the one who's like, I'm not comfortable with this. I'm not comfortable with the idea of just you and me going with Lily. I'm not comfortable with it. This is our oldest son. What kind of message are we sending to our other children about holy matrimony? And here's Sam and his fiance wanting to get married in the church. And the priest is it's going to be a very special thing. How do we do this? And we just made the commitment. We're going to fly, and we'll stay in a hotel, and we'll have all those expenses and all those things that go into it. But do we really want to say, well, no, you know what? We don't trust God that he wants us to keep some of Sam's siblings at home and not be there to see their brother get married because of a couple of plane tickets. And that just didn't make sense to us. And again, there's that trust. Do we
have
trust
to step
or not?
Out on faith that we're going to purchase the largest number of tickets we have ever done.
Is that true?
In our life.
I guess when we've flown all together in the past, it was paid for.
It's always paid for by somebody else.
Because of speaking or whatever. Hey, maybe I can get a speaking gig in Cedar Rapids to pay for it. All right, priests in Cedar Rapids, if you want us to come talk, we have Thursday night free.
That's it. No, we don't even have that.
Well, no, Sam might have to work until 8 o'clock. So if you want us to talk.
Everybody needs to rehearse but Sam. We'll just tell him, you stand here, Sam, and we'll figure out everything else without you. We'll have a proxy groom.
So between 3 and 4 in the afternoon, we're available to talk. So if you want to pay for our play tickets.
We have never purchased 6 tickets in our life anywhere. And it's like, okay.
Will it be 6 for it?
Yes, our family plus Walter. 6 tickets.
Wait a minute, 5? Yeah.
And we've never done that. So, okay. So this is the human part of us was like, Lord, we don't have the money. We can't. Or we just trust God, that God will provide as he always does somehow in some unsuspecting way. All I know is we have to do this. We have to be there as a family to support our son.
And God will take care of the rest of it.
So that he can receive a sacrament, in the church. So we are apparently going to Iowa in mid-August for our very first wedding.
It'll be a whirlwind, but
very, very quick because school would have just started. For the boys.
And Sam just started his new job. So he literally... Yeah.
He doesn't have any time off at all. So
he doesn't even have adjacent days off for his job. He doesn't have 2 days off in a week.
Right.
The way that his schedule is. But hopefully that'll work out so that he'll have 48 hours off for his wedding. So anyway, going back here, right? So take all this stuff that we just kind of threw at you. And I want to go back to Cardinal Sarah's book.
Yeah, and I want to make sure we answered Chris's question.
I don't remember what Chris's question was.
What are you doing about communion? We kind of and then we just breezed off in another direction.
Okay, what we're doing is we're trying to trust God that he's going to provide us with communion on the tongue.
While kneeling
in due time.
Yes.
And until then, we are going to make a spiritual communion. Because here's kind of what
we're doing it for God.
After a show, I always have regrets of things that I wish I had said, and I didn't. And I'm sure that there's going to be some here right now. But what I want to say is, we are in a period in history right now where trusting in God is more important than I think ever before. And I know that says a lot. I mean, it's like, what are you talking about, Greg? There's been wartime, there's been famine and plague. Yeah, I know, but I think that humanity is sick right now because we have so far removed ourselves from God, and families are broken, and the idea of sexuality is so broken, and the idea of church is so broken, and so just we're broken. We're such a broken people, not just as a society, but individually. But if we do what Cardinal Sarah recommends, I do believe that it can change everything. We reform the church when we start by changing ourselves. Let us not hesitate, each one in his place, to denounce sin, starting with our own. What in your life is causing additional division? Are you posting and forwarding messages about any subject that are going to make someone else feel separate from you? Whether it be about their masks that they're wearing or they're not wearing, about the person that they're going to vote for or not going to vote for, about the way that they believe in the coronavirus or not believe in it, about the way that they practice something at church or not practice it. What are you doing to cause division? And repent of it. And then don't do it anymore. What are you doing in terms of your own behavior? What are you watching? What are you saying? What are you thinking? What are you doing? How much have you completely entrusted yourself to God? How much have you surrendered completely to God? How much have you given yourself wholeheartedly, body, mind, and soul, to God? How much have you turned yourself over to God to let Him lead you? Because here's the deal. No one loves you more than Him. Nobody. Nobody can take care of you as well as He can. Now, I'm not suggesting that we all just, you know, quit our jobs and just sit around and watch Netflix all day. That's not what God would want. And we're not doing that. We work very hard for what we do. We basically, as missionaries, we're taking a different approach to the way that we're doing things. Maybe that's what you're called to do. But I also think about the single people that are listening. Is God still calling you to a vocation, and have you closed them off? The married people, are you contracepting? Have you closed God off from the marital act? Are you doing anything, take an honest accounting of your behavior? Are you doing anything that is keeping you from God? Because right now, in this world of turmoil, each of us, as the members of the one body, when one of us sins, we all take responsibility. No, let me say that again. When one of us sins, and we all sin, when we sin, we do damage to the body of Christ. So you have a certain level of culpability. Your sinfulness causes pain and damage to the body of Christ. If we want to be healed, then the first step is to repent and seek the forgiveness of God and to stop sinning.
I'm pretty sure Cardinal Sarah said this. And if he did not, I'm sure he thought it. And that is the best way to save your soul, your sanity, and the church is on your knees. Restore the relationship between you and the one true God. First and foremost, that is how the Reformation needs to begin, is with you revering and worshiping our God.
I'm going to say one last thing. Taking everything that we just said. So last fall, you may remember, I started a program called Exodus 90, and I didn't finish it. And it was very strict. I had to, you know, gave up alcohol. That's all I remember. No, gave up alcohol.
It was all over. Oh, Lord.
I mean, no. I was taking cold showers and had to have a holy hour every day. I mean, there's like all these restrictions.
And fasting.
Yeah. And let me just say, I could have a whole other conversation about whether or not that program needs some remodeling, but that's not where I'm going with this. I'm not sitting here being a promoter of that right now. But my point is that there were some people that we heard from that kind of made comments of like, you make me feel like I'm not a good Catholic because I'm not doing all these things, because I'm not fasting and I'm not on my knees. That's just more division that, granted, we were the cause of. But I will say this. When we are talking, take Exodus 90 and toss that out the window for a second. When we talk about things like the Ten Commandments and your sins, or the church's teachings on something, you know, the church doesn't teach that you have to do Exodus 90. The church does have particular teachings that we're all supposed to follow. They're grounded in scripture and tradition, and therefore are good. They're not just restrictions. Therefore are good for your benefit. But if you feel like, well, when you talk about that teaching, it's just too hard, or I don't like it, well, then that's a start right there. That's a Judas statement. That's a Judas statement. If you start thinking, well, it's like, well, that doesn't apply to me, or there's got to be a different way or a better way. And that's a hard thing for me to say. But if we are at a time in, well, I don't know if I want to go down this pathway, but if we're in a time right now where things are going to get worse, you need to be starting to take extreme measures of becoming better.
Start with the Ten Commandments. That's an excellent and easy place to start. Read them again.
Yes and no. Because
it's about keeping God and the Sabbath holy. Yeah, about revering our Lord.
But some of those, like, thou shalt not steal, right? Okay, I haven't stolen anything. You sure about that? Are you stealing time because you're not working every hour that you, mm-hmm. you know, are you giving a good hard day's work for a good day's pay? Are you, you know, borrowing someone else's passwords to access something online? Are you downloading music or whatever that you didn't pay for? I mean, all those things, those are all forms of stealing, right? And so the Ten Commandments, I feel like if anything, and you know, you bought the 1962 Catechism just recently, I feel like that we need to be spending more time of like, what are the commandments really saying? Just honor thy mother and father. Okay, all right, I'm honoring my mom and dad. Are you honoring your mother and father? I mean,
you can unpack each commandment.
And so when you just say, well, just start with the Ten Commandments, my concern is that someone could just go, yeah,
raise the list.
I'm good. What I'm suggesting is, well, here, let me take it one step further. So when Cardinal Sarah says we reform the church when we start by changing ourselves, are you holy? Are you holy?
No, I'm just valid.
Are you seeking a life of holiness? I'm not saying, are you a good person? Are you seeking a life of holiness? That's what we should be doing. That's going to change the world.
Right. So what does that look like? When you really focus on holiness and you look at how you worship God in Mass, you can see that there's potentially areas of improvement for how you personally are worshiping God in Mass. Even in its current weird state of distancing and masks and hand sanitizer, I get it. It doesn't look like a church we recognize, really. We're not gathering like we're used to. But even there, God is still there. He is still in the tabernacle, and he is still deserving of all your heart, mind, soul, love, respect, everything. It is still an occasion to kneel and bow down before God himself.
So a lot of things that we're thinking about, obviously, and not all of it is conclusive thought. And again, you know, in these days, a lot of the things that we're all thinking, we're all trying to process a million different perspectives, trying to figure out what is right, what is truthful. And it's a challenge. But again, right now, I think the biggest thing that we all need to be doing is challenging ourselves in terms of our levels of holiness. What are the areas in our lives that, you know, take the conversation from the media out of the equation. Take all of the hubbub and angst and division on Facebook and Twitter out of the equation. What is it right now that is separating you, not from each other, but from God? And if you are truly looking to transform your life and to completely conform yourself to the holiness of God, God's level of holiness, not the world's level, when we all start doing that, honestly, when we take an honest look at ourselves, things are going to start changing. One last thing, and I'll say this, that Cardinal Sarah was talking about. He gave an image, and I hope that he's going to go into this a little bit more deeply in this book, but it's the idea of oftentimes in this world, we are walking through the world, and what we oftentimes neglect to do is turn around and look back at the face of Jesus, that we don't want to look him squarely in the eyes. Because if we look back, and he's going kind of in an opposite direction from the rest of the world. We're sort of in the stream, and the stream is taking us down, and we need to turn around. Well, we don't want to look at Jesus because he's going to reveal something to us that we know that we need to change, but we don't want to. And we all have these areas, whether it be a struggle with spending time with the poor, giving to the poor, being charitable, or it is a particular teaching that you struggle with, or you don't agree with why the church says what it does about sexuality, or about a myriad, list of topics. The truth of the matter is that we are not called to be merely human. We are called to be in the image and likeness of God. And we can't be in the image and likeness of he who is perfect and he who is merciful and all merciful and all loving if we ourselves are not willing to look at our weaknesses and truly be willing to change and call out to God and ask for help in making that happen. So just a lot of food for thought. Love to hear your opinions as always. Voicemail is the favorite way because then we hear your voices and we can hear your tone and we don't have to kind of imagine what you mean when you say things. We can hear what you mean. And so pick up your phone, record your voicemail, and email it to us, feedback@gregandjennifer.com. You can find show notes and links to everything we talked about on this episode over at gregandjennifer.com/333. That's the episode number, gregandjennifer.com/333.
And remember, if you are shopping on major online retailers like Amazon and you wish to support Rosary Army, you can do that. You just go over to smile.amazon.com and you can select Rosary Army Corp as your charitable organization of choice. And then Amazon will give us a teeny tiny little kickback, but it does add up because last month, I think Rosary Army received about $120, I think, for shopping from everyone. So that's like super awesome. And it really makes a difference to Rosary Army Corp. So of course we're not doing a Rosary Army podcast right now, but sometimes everything gets a little intertwined together.
Hey, they listen because they want to know what we're dealing with. We're dealing with Rosary Army. So
this is what we're dealing with.
And if you want to support our family specifically, there's three different ways that you can support us, the Willits family, patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. It's an easy way. $5 a month will get you started, getting bonus content, all sorts of other stuff. And it's so helpful. It adds up when enough people sign up at just $5 a month. It makes such a huge difference in our lives. You have no idea. Patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. Thank you to those of you who have made one-time tips. Just recently, Zena gave one for in honor of Jennifer's birthday. Yay! Over at paypal.me/Greg and Jennifer. That's a way of making a one-time tip to us. And of course, go and visit willitsworks.com and buy something. Buy a Rosary Army t-shirt that supports the ministry. Buy an Adventures in Imperfect Living t-shirt. Buy one of my rosary mugs. Go buy something. As always, thank you for being here. And you are awesome, and you are not alone. We'll talk to you next week.
God bless.